Hello everyone, this is Dr. John Morris, and I'd like to welcome you to a study of Isaiah, a very important book for the Old Testament, obviously, but I think you'll find that it's a very important book for the New Testament. It's one of the most quoted books in the New Testament. It's a favorite of Paul. It obviously shows up all over the Gospels, and I think you might be surprised and interested to find out that it shows up all over the book of Revelation, too. So I really think we can say that Isaiah spans the New Testament, and it was very much an alive document for the creators of the New Testament. I think it's very much an alive document for us today because it speaks to us today in exactly the same way that it spoke to its original audience and Jesus's audience. It's a message that the kingdom is near and judgment is coming with the kingdom, and we need to repent and return to the covenant of God. Now, in the Old Testament, it's the Exodus covenant. In the New Testament, it's the new covenant with Jesus, and that's what we're called to do. Now, one of the challenges we have to face about Isaiah is that it can be scary. If I ask that question in class, very often I get, well, it's scary, it's confusing, I don't know how to interpret it, and we tend to avoid it because of that reason. Well, I think in this class, we have a different way maybe of approaching Isaiah. We've got some tools that will help you understand Isaiah, and hopefully by the time you get through, you'll say, well, you know, there's still a lot of things there that I don't understand, but I feel like I've got a better handle on how to interpret Isaiah, and I'm no longer scared of it. So hopefully we'll be able to get you past that confusion and fear. And there is some legitimate reason. Isaiah is a long book. It's 66 chapters, and it covers decades of time, so it can be very, very hard to interpret. But I'll just go over kind of quickly some of the tools we're going to use, and hopefully give you an idea as we get deeper into the class what you'll be able to do. The first thing we want to talk about is the literary context. Isaiah as a piece of literature. It's presented as literature. So I think we can look at it like that. Doesn't take anything away from the sacred nature. But we've got to remember that Isaiah was written over decades to a lot of different audiences, and we have to read it with that understanding. Now, we're in the middle of a political campaign now, and think about if you wrote down every speech of one of the political candidates over a one-year period of time. Now, talking to a lot of different audiences, but there would be a lot of repetition. There'd be a lot of speeches you'd have to write down. And it would be very confusing because you wouldn't understand the context. Talking to the NRA might be very, very different than talking to the Daughters of the American Revolution. I don't know. I just kind of picked two things out of the air. But Isaiah, on one level, is the same thing. He spoke to a lot of different audiences, foreign audiences and Hebrew audiences, and he spoke to them over a long period of time. Now, one of the reasons I think we have a lot of repetition in Isaiah is because he was speaking the same message to different audiences because of the time span. Might have even been generations. So the same basic message of repent and return is given over and over again to different audiences because they need to hear it. They're not doing it. So if we just understand that, it automatically gives us a little bit better handle on why we see so much repetition in Isaiah. And we kind of have to hone in and say, what's the context? What's the historical context? Who is he speaking to? What's going on in the history of the world? And if we understand that, all of a sudden we have the foundation to understand who he was talking to, why he was talking to it, and what the message meant to them. So I would strongly recommend that you rely on your textbook. It's got great context. It's got great background. If you have a study Bible, I would certainly use that. If you want to use the internet, some research, I think that would be great in the case of Isaiah. So, you know, you may want to Google historical context of the book of Isaiah or something like that. So the more you understand the politics of Israel and Judah, the split kingdom, the more you understand the politics of the surrounding neighbors of Israel, the more all these oracles and strange things are going to make sense to you. And you're going to go, oh, I understand what that means. Isaiah's talking about this historical situation, and I've got it put in context. Another tool we're going to be talking about is genre. And genre is just a type of literature, and Isaiah has a number of different types of literature in it. It's got poetry. It's got narrative. Again, looking at that doesn't take anything away from the sacred nature of the text, but it gives us tools to interpret the text. Just think for a minute. if you tried to use the rules of football to understand or run a baseball game. Wouldn't work too well. Can't use bats in football, and you don't run around the bases in football. But so it'd be very, very confusing. We wouldn't know what was going on. So the Bible is the same way. When we read poetry in Isaiah, we've got to look for images and symbolism and emotion and metaphors. When we read narrative, we're looking for historical content. So one of the tools for using Isaiah is identifying the genre of the particular passage you're looking at. And it might be a woe oracle, and we interpret woe oracles in a certain way, different from narrative. So that'll give us a tool too. Once we understand that, then we can interpret it a little bit better. We don't want to use the same rules of interpretation for narrative as we do for genre. Another thing that hopefully will be able to help is to start looking for literary markers. Now, when I say literary markers, I'm talking about specific words that Isaiah used to identify the beginning of a passage and the end of a passage. So it separates that passage. You don't even need to look for chapters and verses if you look for these literary markers. And a typical one, passage might start. It's a shift in subject, a shift in time, a shift in scene, and it may start with something like, in the days of King so-and-so. Now, Isaiah has set that off from the other passages, so we know that's the beginning of the literary marker. And we can find the end of the passage. Sometimes there'll be a summation statement, there'll be a therefore, but very often what we see at the end of the passage is the beginning of another passage. So we might start a passage with, in the days of King Uzziah, or something like that, and the new passage will start, woe to Damascus, or something like that. So watch for these literary markers. It'll help you identify the passage, identify the genre, identify the context, and then you're kind of equipped to better understand Isaiah. One last thing to help us is going to be outlines. And I think the textbook is the table of contents in the textbook is a very, very good outline of Isaiah. And if you kind of follow that, what that will do is that will help you keep focused on the forest. You'll see the big picture. Is this Isaiah 1, Isaiah 2, Isaiah 3? And we'll talk more about that as we go through. Is this a woe oracle to the nations? Is this something else? And if you have kind of an overall map, then you tend to not get lost in the weeds. So that's kind of how we're going to be going through Isaiah. We're going to spend a lot of time with the text because I think there is power in the text. The more time you spend in the text and listening to the Holy Spirit, I think God will speak to you and you will understand Isaiah better and you will know how to apply it in your life. Final thing is, if you're not familiar with the online class format, it's very, very different from an in-class format, and that I'm relying on you to keep up. I'm not going to see you each week in class to remind you about things. You've got to identify all the due dates. You've got to meet all the due dates. The way Sakai is set up is there are automatic penalties for late work that I just really don't have any control over. So the work has to be in and on time. And if I could leave you with one final piece of advice, is again, since we won't be meeting face to face, if there is a problem, if you have any kind of thing that's going to delay you or cause you a concern, let me know. If I know there's a problem beforehand, I can work with you. We can adapt something and help you. If I don't know there's a problem and 5 days gone past the due date, there's not a lot I can do. So if you're having trouble, let me know early, let me know often, and we can almost always work something out. But don't let me know after the fact, because then very often it's too late to do anything. So don't want to scare you too much, but online classes do require an extra level of discipline. So just be ready for that. If you have any other questions, feel free to give me an email. It's jmorris@point.edu. Otherwise, I'll be seeing you around the forums. Bye-bye.